Good morning. I'm Peter Johnston. Welcome to this service of First Presbyterian Church in Salina. We're glad you are joining us electronically, whether you are listening to the radio broadcast on KINA 910 AM or 107.5 FM, or watching our online video stream on Facebook or YouTube. If you would like a copy of the bulletin to follow along, you may find that either on the church's Facebook page or at our website, fpcsalina.org. As you know, this is Pastor Charlie's last worship service with us, so we're particularly glad that you're participating this morning, and we're grateful for Pastor Charlie's ministry with us over these years. Charlie and Diana, we wish you both Godspeed and much happiness in your move to Oklahoma and in your days ahead. We will miss you both. And now please join me in prayer. O God, light of the minds that know you, life of the souls that love you, strength of the thoughts that seek you, help us so to know you that we may truly love you, so to love you that we may fully serve you, whose service is perfect freedom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. It is only by the power of God that we are able to stand against evil. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. God, you send us as prophets to proclaim your coming reign. You send us out as witnesses to embody your justice, kindness, and mercy. Yet we shrink from your call to serve as messengers of your kingdom. We cling to safe surroundings and turn from the demands of discipleship. Forgive us, we pray. Embolden us and send us again as heralds of your good news. Now stand firm in your faith, covered by the saving grace of God, and ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia, and thanks be to God. Thank you.
children belong, welcomed as part of the worshiping throng. Water, God's word, bread and cup, prayer and song. This is where children belong.
Good morning. Happy Sunday to each of you. I know that the weather has brought us lots of heat lately, so hopefully you all are staying cool and enjoying the summer days. So today is a bittersweet day. Now, I don't know if any of you have heard that term before. I'm sure some of you have, but maybe some of you haven't. So if you don't know what bittersweet means, I will explain that to you. Bitter, as we all know probably, is when you have something that just doesn't really feel or taste right. Like you just don't feel good about it necessarily. But then we have sweet, which means that it is so special and it's very, sweet for lack of a better word, and that we're looking forward to something. So you can think of probably many things that are bittersweet. So for example, one thing that comes to my mind is my son growing up way too fast. So when I think of little Glenn, I'm like, it's so bittersweet because I love seeing him grow, but at the same time, it's so sad because I want him to stay little and I want to cherish this time. And so today, as I came to worship, I was thinking, what is the word that describes the way that I am feeling today? And that word is bittersweet. And some of you may know why, and some of you might not, but if you don't know, today is Pastor Charlie's last Sunday as pastor of First Presbyterian Church. So he and Diana will be moving to Oklahoma, and we are so excited for them. And that is the very sweet part of it, is we know that they are excited and that they're looking forward to this new journey. And for that reason, we are excited too. But it's also a little bitter because we have so many great memories that we love about Pastor Charlie and Diana, and we so wish that we could continue on. But we know that this is the journey that God has set for them, and we're so, so, so excited for them. So when I think of bittersweet moments, I think to myself, what are ways that I can remember them, right? So when I'm going through bittersweet times, like thinking of my son and how fast he's grown, or thinking of all the times that we've had with Charlie and Diana, I think of pictures, and I think of those memories that are forever ingrained in our heads. And so, as many of you children know, we had a little project that we worked on this week regarding pictures and Charlie. So if Pastor Charlie could come around down here in front of the pulpit, I have a little something. You might have to come on this side, right, for the camera? Yeah. I have a little something that I would like to give to you. So all of our children thought about memories that they have had with you. And there were a lot of them. So I'm sure you can guess a few. So the Royals is something that you've taught a lot of children about. The pictures that you had them draw at all of the midweek manas. We even had one that said, I love how Pastor Charlie always told me my pictures look so good, even though I knew that they didn't look good at all. And we've had so many other that you were so kind and caring and loving. And so what we have done is we have put together a little book for you. And it's the 2019-20 Faithful Bible Investigators. And it's our favorite Pastor Charlie memories. And so I will show this to the camera here. What I did is I put the bumblebee suit on the front because that's one of my favorite memories of you. And for many reasons. One, I just loved the times that we had in that suit. That was pretty fun. But also, too, it shows what an enthusiastic and fun and carefree person that you are, and that's one of the many qualities that I love about you. So what you'll find in here, and I'll just show a page or two, are a number of pictures of all of the FBI children and their memory that they will always remember of you. So that way you can go back and you can look in the book and you can remember all of our FPC FBI children and all the many memories you had. So thank you, Charlie, for everything. We're going to miss you. So guys, thank you for taking the time to send me those memories, and hopefully you will always hold on to the many memories that you had with Pastor Charlie and all of the many memories, hopefully he'll hold on, and I'm sure he will, of the ones that he had with each of you. And so on this bittersweet day, let us thank God for new transitions and for changes that, although they're not always easy, they are meant to be. And we know that it's God's will for us. So let's go ahead and bow our heads and say a prayer. Dear God, on this day, which is so bittersweet, we know that this is the move that you have called Diana and Charlie to move forward in. We pray for safety and health and happiness and a smooth and easy transition for them. We know that this isn't easy for anyone, but we know that you are standing right next to us every step of the way and have a great plan for each and every one of us. And all God's children said, Amen.
Let us pray. Living God, with joy we celebrate the presence of your risen word. Enliven our hearts by your Holy Spirit, so that we may proclaim the good news of eternal and abundant life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first scripture reading this morning comes to us from Romans chapter 6, verses 12 through 23. Listen now for the word of the Lord. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion in your mortal bodies to make you obey their passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. What then? Should we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? By no means. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that you, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient from the heart to the form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and that you, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. I'm speaking in human terms because of your natural limitations. For just as you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. So what advantage did you then get from the things of which you now are ashamed? The end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and enslaved to God, the advantage you get is sanctification. The end is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Our gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 10th chapter. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of those will lose their reward. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And please join me in prayer. God be in my head and in my understanding. God be in my eyes and in my looking. God be in my mouth and in my speaking. God be in my heart and in my thinking. God be at my end and at my departing. Amen. As Peter Johnston said a few moments ago, reading the passage from Romans, Paul wrote to that church, "The free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Free gift. No, I'm sorry. Forgive me, Paul, but as a former copy editor and ink-stained wrench, I have to point out there is no such thing. A free gift? Tell me, when was the last time you had to pay for a gift that you received? A free gift? All gifts are free. What we have here is an oxymoron, a contradiction in terms, like jumbo shrimp. Think about it for a minute. Another example of an oxymoron might be balcony sermon. Remember those? I'd hope to preach from the balcony today, but in this age of COVID-19, like so much else, I had to adapt to a new reality, chained for technological reasons to this pulpit so that you can hear and see me at the same time. For some of you, a balcony sermon just didn't fit. It was an oxymoron. As one of you said after the last time I preached from up there, "We could have stayed home and listened to this on the radio. It ain't a sermon unless we can see you in the pulpit." Another said pithily, "Cute stunt. Don't ever try that again." But that, you see, was the point, my friends. Yes, it was different. Maybe it was a contradiction in terms. Maybe it was an oxymoron. But it achieved its purpose, I think, presenting something different in a different way to spur different ideas, different thoughts, maybe even different dreams, an effort to take us to another place, another height, so that we might see things from another perspective, even to gaze beyond the horizon, to catch a glimpse of God out in the world. Did it work? You're a better judge of that than me. Of that and other different ways this old country preacher proclaimed the word over the past 5 years. Remember Throwback Sunday? Remember the Kirkin? Remember Manna at the Manor? Though 5 years is but a blip in the life of this historic, fond 160-year-old church, memories and memorable moments have occurred, at least in my mind. I often say the two most holy moments that filled my heart were when we laid hands in ordination and installation, and when you came forward for communion and I could see each of you in your eyes. Others, of course, would be the many weddings, the funerals, the baptisms that have occurred over the past few years. Remember that baby whose separation anxiety was so acute that its parents were terrified when I scooped her up into my arms? "Jesus loves me" came in handy that day for this baby whisperer. Here's another oxymoron then. Baptismal death. It just doesn't fit, does it? In baptism, we talk about rebirth, we talk about new creation, we talk about new life, cleansing, God's claiming and sealing, but death? But that's the point, you see, the point that Paul was trying to make in that passage that we read from Romans. In your baptism, Paul preaches, you've already died, and in your baptism, you've already been reborn. That means death no longer has any dominion over you, and you can fear no longer has hold over you. Jesus died once and for all, so that you all must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to all that is good in God in Christ Jesus. We need not fear death, friends, For in our baptisms, we've already died. When I hold a baby in baptism, the first things I think and I talk about aren't the child's death to sin, as the child's death to all that would separate her from God and others, as her death to all the powers and principalities that would try to take hold of her life. It sounds jarring, doesn't it? It sounds jarring to speak of baptism as death. Yet there is this story. Episcopal priest and author John Westerhoff writes about a jarring baptism he witnessed at a small country church in Latin America. The congregation had gathered. They'd recalled God's gracious acts, just as Paul did in Romans. Now it was time for them to respond to God's living word with a baptism. But where we might play Jesus Loves Me or Baptized in Water or a similar hymn, at this small church, the congregation began the baptism with the mournful sounds of a funeral hymn. Westerhoff watched a solemn procession move down the center aisle. A father carried a child's coffin he had made from wood, and a mother carried a bucket of water from the family well, and a priest carried their sleeping infant wrapped only in a native blanket. As they all reached the chancel, the father placed the coffin on the altar, and the mother poured the water in the coffin, and the priest covered the wakening body's skin with embalming oil. The congregation singing softened to a whisper, and the priest slowly lowered that infant into the coffin and immersed the child's head in the water. And as he did so, he exclaimed, "I kill you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen," everyone shouted. And then quickly lifting the child into the air for all to see, the priest then quickly declared, "And I resurrect you that you might love and serve the Lord." And with those words of rebirth and resurrection, the congregation immediately broke into a joyous Easter hymn. Can you imagine that happening here? It's such a powerful image, and maybe remembering our daily death to sin and how rebirth in grace, that free gift, oxymoron as it is, of God in Jesus Christ, has affected our life together and the way that we live out our faith. Maybe the reality that every baptism becomes an Easter moment might keep us grounded in what it means to be fully alive. Maybe that rehearsing of letting go into God, of trusting that in our baptisms we've already died, maybe that reminder renders the occasional church fight over the pastor or whatever mundane, and any grumblings would pale in comparison. Perhaps it helps us to keep our focus on living as one body and not thinking that we all have to agree or even sometimes like each other. Probably, though, we'll still argue with each other about what it means to be faithful and about who gets to decide what. We'll always have our share of discontent because, honestly, it's part of what it means to be a church and a family of faith together. And yet, as Paul tried to do with those words to the Romans, those hard, difficult words, we can dream. Our eyes are lifted, maybe even to the balcony, and we can see that bigger picture, God's bigger picture, the picture that reminds us that in our baptism, we've all died to everything that separates us from God and from one another, and that because of that, we're free, free with that free gift of God to live as one body, not because of how good we are, but because of how good God is in Christ Jesus. It's all about bold grace, friends. It's all about baptismal life, and it's all about what it means to be one in Christ. How about another oxymoron? Hello, goodbye. The hardest things to say in life are hello for the first time and goodbye for the last time, because each goodbye we say helps prepare us for that final goodbye at death. Hello, goodbye. Goodbye, hello. There are many ways to say goodbye. It may be difficult, but it's important that it be said itself, not only by the one leaving, but by the ones who are staying too, because it's tough to be left with no warning, with no chance to speak words of appreciation, of apology, and if nothing else, to simply say goodbye. Roy Oswald of the Alban Institute tells this story from his childhood. When I was a boy, Oswald says, I was about age 6 growing up in rural Saskatchewan. My two older brothers and I would often decide to walk home from school over the fields rather than along the road. It was a shorter route, but occasionally we'd come upon enormous thistle patches. I can't remember seeing anything like it since, but those thistle patches sometimes used to extend for a half mile or more. In places, the prickly patches would be 50 feet to 100 feet wide, and in other places, 10 to 20 feet. The rest of the field lying fallow in summer was tilled soil. We rarely wore shoes to school in the summertime, and hence that was our dilemma. How to cross those thistle patches in bare feet? We did have the choice of walking around them, of course, but since it was the end of the day, we were all tired and hungry, anxious to get home, and Mother usually had a snack treat for us to tide us over till supper. That meant to walk around the patch would take us out of the way and take us longer. The only other option was to back up and run through the narrowest part at full speed. Being the youngest with the least speed and the smallest leg span, I always objected to this idea. I was usually overruled, though, by my two older brothers, who would then each take me by one hand and run me through that thistle patch. I can still vividly remember the experience, running full speed in bare feet across 20 feet of prickly thistles, yelping in pain all the way through. And when the three of us reached the black soil on the other side, we'd immediately hit the dirt and start pulling out those few thistle ends that had stuck in our feet. I had four briars get me. How many did you get? Was a sample of our post-agony conversation. For me, Oswald says, this story illustrates how some pastors and churches approach their end periods. They rightly assume that there will be pain involved, so their approach is to run it through it as fast as they can. Yet the emotions of such a time as this are deep and powerful. It's a time to grieve, a time to sense loss. Trying to juggle the conflicting emotions of grief as well as of joy, of pain at leaving, and of anticipation of a new kind of life is a difficult balance, isn't it? Advice given to Paul, though, fits here, too. Face your goodbyes instead of dodging or disappearing. Use your own words, speak the truth in love, listen, and hold your head high as you depart. And as those who stay, face the music of farewell, say hello and say goodbye. We should also recognize the spiritual dimension of farewells, of course. Our English word goodbye is a shortened form of God be with you. Both the Spanish adios and French adieu are literally translated to God, a way of commending each other to the care of the Almighty as we depart each other's presence. So let's this day say hello, goodbye, goodbye, hello in a good way. This is now my third congregation and the third goodbye in my 17 years of ministry. I can promise you it doesn't get any easier each time. Frankly, you've broken my heart, but in a good way. Broken open my heart to teach me how to love each other and how to love every one of you. You've been more than understanding. You've taught me much. You've practiced hospitality in much the way that Jesus talked about in Matthew, a refreshing cup of cold water. We've had our ups and downs, yes, but God has been good. And goodness, we've had some fun together, haven't we? Still, let me be frank. There's no way for anyone to engage in pastoral leadership without rubbing somebody the wrong way. As a runner, I can appreciate that ministry is a marathon, or half marathon in my case, and not a sprint. As John Ortberg says, leadership is the art of disappointing people at a rate they can stand. To anyone whom I've disappointed or inadvertently hurt or upset, or those who've not felt a member of this family of worship, I sincerely apologize with my heart. Such difficulties are all a part of being in community with one another. If God intended all of us to see things the same way, we wouldn't have been created to be so different from one another. And I pray that you might find your way back home into this family of faith after I leave. So what can you do in the days ahead? Well, first of all, do all the wonderful things you're already doing. Keep working, keep sharing to further the ministry and mission of this proud church. Secondly, be honest. Be honest with each other. Share your sadness, share your hurt, share your anger if it's there, and know that that's all okay. Let's neither of us rush through that thistle patch in order to try to avert any pain. Finally, friends, I find myself this day echoing other words of Paul. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. It's right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace along with me. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Having heard the word proclaimed, we now affirm our faith. This is a lengthy reading, as by tradition the past 5 years, around the 4th of July, we read the parts of the Barman Declaration to remind us of our ultimate allegiance to Jesus Christ. And so hear these words. Jesus Christ, as he attested for us in Holy Scripture, is the one word of God which we have to hear and which we have to trust and obey in life and in death. We reject the false doctrine as though the church could and would have to acknowledge as a source of its proclamation, apart from and besides this one word of God, still other events and powers, figures and truths as God's revelation. As Jesus Christ is God's assurance of the forgiveness of all our sins, so in the same way and with the same seriousness is he also God's mighty claim upon our whole life. Through him befalls us a joyful deliverance from the godless fetters of this world for a free, grateful service to his creatures. We reject the false doctrine as though there were other areas of our life in which we would not belong to Jesus Christ, but to other lords, areas in which we would not need justification and sanctification through him. The Christian church is the congregation of the brethren in which Jesus Christ acts presently as the Lord in word and sacrament through the Holy Spirit. As the church of pardoned sinners, it has to testify in the midst of a sinful world with its faith as with its obedience, with its message as with its order, that it is solely his property, and that it lives and wants to live solely from his comfort and from his direction in the expectation of his appearance. We reject the false doctrine as though the church were permitted to abandon the form of its message and order to its own pleasure or to changes in prevailing ideological and political convictions. We reject the false doctrine as though the church could and were permitted to give to itself or to allow it to be given to it special rulers vested with ruling powers. We reject the false doctrine as though the state, over and beyond its special commission, should and could become the single and totalitarian order of human life, thus fulfilling the church's vocation as well. We reject the false doctrine as though the church, over and beyond its special commission, should and could appropriate the characteristics, the tasks, and the dignity of the state, thus itself becoming an organ of the state. The church's commission upon which its freedom is founded consists in delivering the message of the free grace of God to all people in Christ's stead, and therefore in the ministry of his own word and work through sermon and sacrament. Amen.
All these Christ of the upward way, my guide divine. When you have set your feet, may I place mine. And when your blessed call comes serene and clear, come, may my answer be, Lord, I am here.
This morning's prayers of the people comes from Jill Duffield of the Presbyterian Outlook. Let us pray. Lord God, we bow in prayer, humbled by the reality that you want to spend time with us. You long to be in relationship with us. You receive us and care for us, no matter where we have been, what we have done, or how often we have neglected your will. Such knowledge is too wonderful for us, such grace beyond our comprehension. We rest in your compassionate presence, freed from sin and alive to the transformation you promise. Awed by your mercy and kindness, we seek to respond with bold faith. Strengthen our resolve to follow where Christ leads and obey his commandment to love. In a world overflowing with anger and division, send us to be ambassadors of reconciliation. In the wake of injustice and pain, use us as instruments of righteousness and healing. As creation groans for relief, make us bearers of hope and catalysts of life-giving change. When our faith is tested and we do not feel up to the demands of discipleship, remind us that you provide. Help us to remember the ram in the thicket, the manna in the desert, the water from the rock, and the feeding of the 5,000. Send your Holy Spirit to spark our imagination and embolden our witness so that none of your little ones are hungry or thirsty. Freed from sin and alive in Christ Jesus, we pray without reserves for those people and places, circumstances and situations that weigh on our hearts and minds this day. We ask you to provide healing to the sick. We look to you to ease the suffering of those hurting in body, mind, and spirit. We plead on behalf of the long oppressed and for those still waiting for justice. We yearn for you to guide all of those in positions of leadership to make decisions that reflect your will. O God, we rest in your compassionate presence, freed from sin, alive, and awaiting the transformation you promise. We make our prayer in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're grateful for a small committee of elders who have planned a drive-by farewell for Charlie and Diana after worship today. Details have been sent via email as well as a letter in the mail. The celebration will be between 11:30 and 12:30. Charlie and Diana will be seated near the south building entrance, and there will be a basket for cards. Despite my best efforts, we were unable to secure a dunk tank. We ask that everyone will enter the parking lot from 8th Street on the southernmost entrance. There will be signs posted with directions once you are in the parking lot. Again, please see your letter or email for further details. And also recommend that everyone stay tuned after the last hymn and just before Charlie gives his charge and benediction for some special presentations, and I truly hope that this will make Charlie a little bit nervous, because hopefully he's not quite sure what this is all about. Please also stay tuned in the coming days for more information about in-person worship at our church. And of course, we ask you to lift our community and those that are helping to guide our efforts to keep people healthy and safe with the recent surge of cases of COVID in Saline County. We invite you to support the ministry of First Presbyterian Church. There are four ways that you can do this. You can mail your donation to P.O. Box 585, Salina, Kansas 67402. Again, that's P.O. Box 585, Salina, Kansas 67402. You can also give on our website, fpcsalina.org, on the Give tab. Again, that's fpcsalina.org on the Give tab. You can text your offering as well. Simply text the word give or a dollar amount to 785-329-9830. Again, you can text the word give or a dollar amount to 785-329-9830. And finally, you can also download the Church by Ministry One app and search for us there. Again, the app is called Church by Ministry One, where Ministry One is one word. There is only one Lord and God, from whom all things come and for whom we live. Let us offer our lives to the Lord.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts. We offer them to you, and we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And before our closing hymn, I'd like to thank Angie Koshgarian, Jesse Smith, Marianne Weiner, and Britton Zuccarelli for joining Charlie and I to record this morning's music, and Richard Koshgarian for planning it. Our final hymn this morning is Come Live in the Light. So, Charlie, prior to this morning's benediction and charge and benediction, we have a couple of presentations for both of you. The first is in the form of a video. We've asked people to submit photographs and videos. We're going to play the first part of it, which includes a Celtic blessing from Sam Pretty this morning, and you'll be able to see that on the monitor right over here.
A Celtic blessing, the path. God bless the path on which you go. God bless the earth beneath your feet. God bless your destination. God be a smooth way before you, a guiding star above you, a keen eye behind you, this day, this night, and forever. God be with you whatever you pass. Jesus be with you whatever you climb. Spirit be with you wherever you stay. God be with you at each stop and each sea, at each lying down and each rising up, in the trough of the waves, on the crest of the billows, each step of the journey you take.
Charlie and Diana, it's been so great.
And forgive us for cutting that off. We will be sharing the full video, of course, with both of you. You all will have a copy of that, and we'll likely share that on social media as well. We also have one other gift. This is on behalf of the session and the church, and I will give it to you while I read this, and you are welcome to take it out. This is for both of you, and we can make sure that the camera gets a shot of it too. And it should just slide right out, actually. So this is a print titled View from the Mulberry Bridge, and it's by our very own Katie England. This is the official 2019 Smoky Hill River Festival print. And we hope that you will enjoy this reminder of Salina, particularly as Diana works so hard with the Friends of the River Foundation campaign to fund the restoration of the old channel of the Smoky Hill River. So I present this to you on behalf of the session of First Presbyterian Church in gratitude for your 5 years with us.
Thank you so much.
That's wonderful. And I personally will say that I look forward to us staying in touch. And I'm very, very grateful for the 5 years that we've gotten to spend together and for the many ways that Diana is constantly helping me to improve. So thank you all. I wish I could give you both a hug right now. So air hugs.
Virtual hugs.
Thank you.
And I will allow you to give our charge and benediction.
Friends, God's grace fortifies us with a sense of vocational purpose and a sacred calling. I close with these words. I am only one, but I am one. I cannot do everything, but I can do something. What I can do, I ought to do. And what I ought to do, by the grace of God, I will do. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Wonderful.
And you remember I love the